In a previous video, we talked about how you might be able to run some queries, some T-SQL queries, to verify your deployment of Azure SQL. Thought I'd show you some examples of that. Right here, I'm actually using the tool Azure Data Studio, and I'm connected to an Azure SQL database. In fact, if you go right here in the screen, change connection, you can see how you yourself can connect an Azure SQL database. I'm using the logical server, my SQL login, and you can even choose directly a database to connect to. So one of the things I love about Azure Data Studio is the capability of something called a T-SQL notebook. And so I'm using a T-SQL notebook here, which is a combination of markdown text and T-SQL code in form of cells. So this is showing an activity that you yourself can get access to through resources we provided to you to try to run deployment verify queries against Azure SQL database. So the first thing I'm showing you is a query of the popular select add version. You saw Anna do this with Management Studio. And as she pointed out, it shows here I'm actually connected to an Azure SQL backend versus SQL Server. What about this version number 12? If you remember in a previous video about the history of Azure SQL, one of the milestones was us launching what we call V12 of Azure SQL database. V12 was around the time frame that we were building SQL Server 2014. So when we made this architecture change, we kind of stamped Azure SQL database as the same version, major version number as SQL Server 2014. Remember, I told you that Azure SQL is versionless. So this version doesn't really change since that time. So you really can't rely on a version number to dictate what features or functionality you have in Azure. You can simply look at this part of ADAT version to know you're connected to Azure. What else and other types of queries might you do? Well, one of them we mentioned was server property. So server property engine edition usually is there to tell you, am I running standard edition, enterprise edition, or even express? But notice here in this case, because we're running Azure SQL, it shows here that our value is 5, which lines up to Azure SQL database. If I was connected to managed instance, I would see a value of 8. Let's go on and see some other queries you might can run. Well, what about sys.databases and sys.objects? Anna showed you in a SQL server with SSMS, you saw the system databases, such as master, model, tempdb, and MSDB. For an Azure SQL database, all you're normally going to see in the context of your user database is the logical master and then the name of your database. Behind the scenes, we are using a physical SQL server, but we're not exposing those information to you. You don't need to see the details of those system databases, whereas you would see it in MI, but you don't see that in an Azure database scenario. Now, why would I run a query against sys.databases? Well, first of all, I want to see just what databases are there, including mine, but I also want to see the properties of the database. You're used to seeing things like, is auto close on? Is it read-only? Is it multi-user? Am I using checksum and what recovery model? So I just kind of go through on any database I deploy in SQL Server, and I look at those properties to see what they look like. We're going to show you in a later video of what are the properties that we allow you to change and what are some of the defaults for Azure SQL database. Now, I look at sys.objects because I just want to get a sanity check. Can in my database I see system tables or other user objects that I've deployed? And I just want to get a look and feel how many objects are in the database just to get started. Well, let me go down even further and show you a query that'll look at something called sys.dmos schedulers. This is a common DMV used in SQL Server, and it usually tells you how many CPUs do I have access to. Sometimes you can look at the error log for that. Remember, we don't have the error log in this case. So quickly by looking at DMOS schedulers, I can tell that I've got two schedulers lined up with two CPUs. Now, does that make sense to me? Well, I deployed, like Anna did, a general purpose 2vCore database. So in the 2vCore database scenario, I would expect to see two schedulers lined up for these CPUs. Going down further, if you're going to look at a SQL server, you might take a look at things like DMOS sysinfo and DM process memory to take a look at the operating system environment surrounding your SQL server. Well, you don't have access to these DMVs in an Azure SQL database because we've abstracted those details from you in the deployment. Well, do you have any other options? We mentioned in the previous video about some special DMVs that are particular to Azure. One of them is called DM User DB Resource Governance. And if you look at the output of this DMV for this database, you're going to find some interesting pieces of information. Number one, something called a slow name. Well, what's a slow name? Remember we said a service tier is like a service level objective? Well, you can see kind of the code name here. This is a general purpose database using Gen 5 hardware with two vCores. And you can verify that with the column that says CPU limit. So I can go through in this DMV and see various types of information about the limits of my Azure SQL database. Like I get 30,000 max sessions, or my max memory grant, or even my sizes of my databases and the limits applied to my Azure SQL database. Now, I mentioned about DMOS job object in a previous video because we use Windows job objects behind the scenes to do certain resource limits. This is very handy because it tells me, for example, the memory limit for my deployment. If you look at the tables that we have for resource limits, you'll find out that for a general purpose 2 vCore deployment, 10 gig is the limit of the memory access for your database. That's a little bit like giving 10 gig to your machine or your virtual machine. So the SQL Server process can only see 10 gig, and then things like max server memory resources and configurations apply within that. So you can look at these two DMVs to get a better perspective of what your deployment looks like and the environment and the Azure infrastructure we're using to deploy it. Now, the last thing I do to kind of do a sanity check in a deployment is I look at the very popular DMV called DM Exec Requests. You know, I look at things like, is the lazy writer running? Is there a log writer or checkpoint handler or recovery writer? And then I look to see not only are these background tasks exist, but are my typical user tasks there as well, including the query that's running my DMV itself. So you can see what I've done here. I've done a combination of using some catalog views, add version, engine property, and some DMVs just to do a sanity check and a verification that the deployment of my Azure SQL database looks exactly as I intended it. An example of using Azure Data Studio, you could have run these queries inside SSMS, and here's a bonus for you. Did you see here and notice that all I did is scroll through the output of this? T-SQL notebooks save the output of your results in a file, and you can share those with your colleagues and the community and your friends. I hope you've enjoyed this example of how to use Azure Data Studio to run T-SQL queries to verify your Azure SQL database deployment. See you on the next video.